So, I'm glad to see you again, and I'd like to tell you to, in this part of the lecture, how you should calculate the spectrum for your course project. So the course project parameters will be given to you in the next lecture when I will show you with example in Octave MATLAB how to write the code and perform the calculations and plot the results. Yes, so now this second lecture we will speak of theoretical expressions, mathematics, Fourier transform, and how we derived those expressions. We are going to use the next part. So this is mostly the additional material for those interested in mathematical transforms and so on. So you can better understand how that result has been obtained. But for course project, it would be quite simple. You will have to program the certain formula, which we will have, and plot the two plots for, well, spectrums of the signal for your modulation type, basically binary amplitude shift keying, frequency shift keying, or phase shift keying. Of course, those parameters will be assigned to you randomly. I'm going to use a randomizer to assign you values and variant numbers. So, well, it's a certain lag which exactly of those modulations you would get. As you figure out, it would be the simplest to calculate the binary amplitude modulation, but don't worry, frequency and phase modulations can be expressed by using amplitude shift keying. So basically this means we are anyway going to calculate binary amplitude shift keying for all of these three cases. So let's start with a simple task before modulation. So as we know, the modulation is simply the translation of spectrum. So basically we translate this baseband spectrum to some carrier frequency during the modulation process. So if we know the spectrum of the initial signal, we can calculate the spectrum of the translated spectrum. Yes, we have talked about modulation theorem last lecture, and we will mention it today again, since that's what we have to do. But at any rate, we have to know this spectrum first if we are going to draw it precisely in this frequency range. So that's why we have to calculate it first. We have to calculate the spectral density for a single rectangular pulse signal. Yes, this is rectangular pulse over the duration of tau, amplitude u, and it is centered at zero time moment. So let's see how can we calculate it. We have to use Fourier transform, integral Fourier transform, to transition from time domain to frequency domain. And for non-periodic signal and random signal and so on, this is calculated as an integral of multiplication between our signal, which we would like to calculate transform for, and a base function represented by a complex exponential of certain frequency omega, for which we are going to calculate the spectral function. So for each value of this spectral function, we take a certain frequency omega and calculate it for all duration of signal, starting from minus infinity, ending by plus infinity, theoretically. Practically, of course, we will have here some finite durations. So in our case, as you can see, it would be from minus tau divided by 2 up to tau divided by 2. Here we are not putting some precise numbers because we want to derive some expression which you could use for your course project, and each of you will have different values of this pulse duration time. So basically you will have to put that inside the obtained formula and get the results. So we are trying to to find the analytical, the generalized expression for any tau value. So what we have to do first is to define this signal as a mathematical function. Math function. We can define it as a piecewise function by defining segments. So basically our signal has two values. It has value of zero if we are outside of the pulse duration interval of tau, and it has u if we are considering the signal in these time limits from minus tau divided by 2 up to tau divided by 2. So two cases, yes. Then we put that inside the integral, and the integral can be splitted into three integrals, yes, from minus infinity up to minus tau divided by 2, where signal has zero value. Now, the central part and the most essential one for which we will have to do calculations is this one. And afterwards, signal is again equal to zero, which basically leads to the... Well, we can actually just exclude those two integrals because they are going to give zero value anyway. Yes, so we will have to work only with this one. We have to calculate that. Well, it's rather simple table integral, but let's take it step by step. First of all, we are going to factor out this j omega term. Yes, where omega is angular frequency of our signal, dv, multiplied by frequency f, which is linear frequency, and j is imaginary unit, that is square root of minus 1. So we are working with complex numbers. So we have factored that into this differential sign and accordingly normalized by this value here. Overall, we have obtained here minus sign. And yes, and that is the minus sign belonging to this. We actually could have written it like this, yes, like minus. But we have put it before our integral, yes, as a constant value, because minus is actually just a constant factor of minus 1. So now we have to integrate this. No, I think actually, yes, that minus has been put before, yes. So we now actually have to integrate a very simple integral. And the result is the same exponent. Yes. Afterwards, we have to put in limits by using Newton-Leibniz formula. And I'm missing some slide here. Let's see, maybe I have changed the order of slides. No, unfortunately, that slide has gone somehow missing. Well, okay, let's put that inside here and see. So first we are putting upper limit. That would give us minus u divided by j omega multiplied by. We put that instead of t. So we get minus j omega tau divided by 2. Now, next, we put minus, and here we had another minus, yes. And we put lower limit, lower bound, yes. So So minus by minus gives us the plus. And we, well, for easier, maybe we could actually just factor out. Well, yes, we could just factor out this constant term, which is not depending on t. So to see easier what we have here, we can put it like this. Yes. So basically what we have here is Euler's formula for sine function, which, well, actually had to have to be divided by 2g. And other than that, we have 1g here. We need to put 2 both to the numerator and denominator, which could be factored out, but we do not going to do that. We are going to use this 2 to write down that sine function. And we get actually this result. And yes, g is gone. Minus is gone because we actually need to calculate like this minus. And we had opposite, yes. So if we put here upper limit, that would give us minus j omega tau divided by 2. And the lower limit would be plus. Yes, we had them opposite, so we factor in that minus sign here in cone. And we have only this expression for spectral density of the single rectangular pulse. Now we calculate the absolute value of it. Well, u is usually positive number, so it can be factored out, which is amplitude of the signal. And we can that into, for example, MATLAB or Octave, and plot the function visually. Yes, as for example here, we have to specify certain parameters for this. But if you do that right now, for example, open up Octave and specify these parameters and put in that function and draw it at the y-axis in the same time, or I mean frequency range as we have specified, then you would get completely the same picture. That is for a single pulse. It's not modulated yet. So basically we can expect that after modulation, our spectrum will just translate by a frequency axis and will look like this at the carrier frequency f0. And that's indeed what we will get. So now, if we have the expression for a non-periodic single rectangular pulse, we can actually make it to be periodical, yes, without the need to calculate those coefficients again. We just can express it from already obtained result. So we are going to do that because in course project you are going to have to draw the spectrum for two cases. The first case is a periodical sequence of signal 1 0 1 0 1 0. So we need to calculate the spectrum in case our signal is periodical. And the second case is random data, which, as we have already talked about last lecture, represents this case of a single pulse, because we are calculating the spectral density, the density per 1 hertz, per 1 period, and 1 symbol duration for such non-periodic signal. So if we have this condition that we now have to actually make a calculate a spectrum for periodical signal, which is still centered around time value zero, then we have to provide additional information about the period. In our case, the period is going to be double duration. So we have a zero symbol and one symbol with equal duration. Yes, equal duration of tau. Then we would need also a main harmonic. Yes, the basic harmonic, the harmonic signal of the same frequency as our rectangular signal. So our rectangular signal has the frequency 1 divided by its period. And the same frequency harmonic is called the base harmonic. And we need its frequency as an angular frequency, yes, omega as 2πf, which can be calculated, well, considering that f is 1 divided by period t, which in its turn is double duration tau. Then we can factor out this and get p divided by tau for the main harmonic, which we will use to draw spectrum. So basically, we will draw the first harmonic, this one. The second harmonic will have twice as great frequency as this one. So basically, it would be complete period up to here. Yes. Now the third harmonic would have 3 times higher frequency than this base harmonic, and so on and so on. The spectrum for periodical signal, I'll remind you, is discrete, and the harmonics exist only at regular frequency values. Meaning here is omega, here is double omega, triple omega, and so on and so on. So we need to know this omega frequency to know at which frequencies those harmonics actually are. In this case, we can derive the complex Fourier series coefficients from our spectral function by making substitution of omega equal to k multiplied by capital omega, where k is the integer number 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. Yes. Now we can make some simplification, not really simplifications, but adjustments for our software, because, well, if omega is equal to 0, we will have no problems calculating this sin, which would give us 0, but we will have to divide 0 by 0, which is not properly handled in all programming languages. We have some special type function called sinc function, which handles this moment. Sinc in octave, it's multiplied by p. So basically, if we divide the result by p, that would give us sin x divided by x. And that is why, knowing that we will have to put that in MATLAB octave, it's desirable for us to represent this spectrum in this form. It's quite simple to do, especially considering that we have, during this transformation, to divide by period, which is double duration or 2 tau. And, well, we have tau, which we can factor in here, and we can factor in this 2 as divided by 2. So basically, this gives us the same argument just by redistributing those symbols. Yes, here that 2 has gone as division by 2 here, and that tau has gone as multiplication by tau here. And we didn't change anything else in that formula except for modulus calculation, and have obtained that sinus x divided by x type function, which we will just simply put in octave. I will show you next lesson how to do that, and you will be able to do the same for your individual variant. So that is still not modulated signal. Now we want to perform modulation, which is spectrum translation. Basically, we will want to translate this spectrum for first task, and this one for the second task, which was continuous signal, yes, random values of ones and zero following for infinity. So let me remind you the modulation theorem. We will get to this time shifting theorem later, but for now we will skip right to the modulation theorem. We don't need currently for amplitude modulation any time shifting. So we will skip right to the binary amplitude shift keying first, and then when we will come to the situation then that we need that time shifting theorem, I will return and tell you more. Yes, so we need to calculate the spectrum of the signal for two cases. The first case, the input data is periodical sequence of zeros and ones. Yes, so we need to calculate in this case the magnitude spectrum, which is discrete since our signal is periodical, and will look like separate harmonics at the different frequencies with central frequency, which is matching our carrier frequency. Now the second task is to calculate the spectral power spectral density. For short, it can be written as PSD. Yes, and that would be a continuous function of the frequency. So it will look like sinus x divided by x. And we already have the spectrum in the baseband, which we can use to translate to our carrier frequency. How are we going to do that? For that, we need to use the modulation theorem once again, and we will use particularly modulation with a sine signal rather than cosine signal. In this case, our spectrum is, well, of course, you could use also cosine signal as well. It's not really of a matter, yes. It would also work just the same. So, but let's consider that we are using sine signal. In that case, our modulated signal spectrum is transformed as follows. So basically, this is our rectangular signal for which we know spectrum, this one, and we have the entire expression to calculate that. Now, if we are performing modulation, all we need to do is substitute the frequency omega with this omega minus omega zero, where omega zero is our desired carrier. So we specify that, or rather than that, for you, that value will be specified already in your course project parameters. So that is given to us anyway, yes. And we have two parts with difference frequency and with some frequency. Of course, here for this to work, omega must be less than zero, and we are not considering this case at all. So basically, we will skip this part, and all that remains is this part. So what we have to do is to take this expression, multiply it by a half and add j, and replace omega with omega minus omega zero. And that would be it. That would perform the modulation for our signal. So, and needless to say that it works both for periodic and non-periodic signals. So transform, this modulation theorem works both in both of these cases. That's what I should have mentioned also. And non-periodic. In non-periodic case, we have spectral function S j omega. In periodic case, we have spectral coefficients C k, calculated and derived here. Yes. So basically, that means that we will take this expression for first task and replace our frequency with the difference k omega minus omega zero. And that would give us this result. Of course, we also don't forget that we had this factor of the half and j. That didn't go anywhere, it multiplied here. And this is the formula for amplitude spectrum of rectangular pulses, periodical rectangular pulses, in case of binary amplitude shift keying. So we can draw it, and it will look like the top picture, this one. We have frequency sum here. So here we have, for example, 1 by 10 in degree of 6, which is 1 megahertz frequency. And we have a carrier as the highest amplitude here. And then we have our rectangular spectrum, which is represented by a sinus x divided by x function. And the same goes for the opposite direction of the frequency, for a difference frequency, and so on. That is the first task. And I will show you how to make the similar picture for some course project variant. Now, the second task requires calculating spectral power density. Power, as we already know, is proportional to squared voltage. So we have to now calculate the square of the spectrum and divide it by the time interval of the single signal period, yes. And we are assuming here that our period of the signal, if it would have been periodical signal, so basically our signal is not periodical, but if it would have been periodical, then our period would be this one. And we are dividing by the same measure both for periodical and non-periodical when we calculate the power spectrum rather than magnitude spectrum. Here is only a magnitude spectrum, here is the power density for random signal. So how do we calculate that? Well, basically we already have that expression where we would need to substitute omega with omega minus omega zero. And we calculate the absolute value, we take the square of this value and divide it by the period, which is represented by two pulses durations. Now, here this spectral function is simply obtained by replacing here k omega with omega, small letter, yes, and multiplying by 2 tau, yes. Basically, we use this function to get this continuous spectral function. And then we calculate square for each frequency and divide by pulse duration. Then we calculate this power density. I will once again show you this and we will record, so you will have a lot of time up to semester end to actually repeat that. And if you have any questions, of course, don't be shy and you can ask me if something is not working or you don't something understand. I will be glad to help you. So if that's taken care of, or at least after you will spend some time on this, you will be able to reproduce this, then we can talk about more advanced modulation types, which are binary frequency modulation and binary phase modulation. Now, don't be alarmed. Actually, it will be quite simple. Let's first consider how our binary frequency shift keying signal can be represented as a superposition of two binary amplitude shift keying signals. If we merge together those two pictures, we would get a frequency manipulated signal. So basically, we can actually consider this signal to be a sum of two separate amplitude shift keyings. However, there is a trick, a small trick, that we need to use a shifted signal. So our initial signal was specified from minus tau divided by 2 to plus tau divided by 2. And here you can see that for the top part of the spectrum, of the signal, I mean, the first signal, the shift has been made in this direction. And the same time for this signal, the shift has been made in this direction. Yes, so you can see that here from the zero moment, we have moved to that direction. And we need to take into account that thing as well. So basically, our spectrum would be for shift keying, frequency shift keying, as a sum of BASK 1 and BASK 2. Also, please know that actually, the carrier frequency for each of those BASK is different. You can see here we have two complete periods per symbol. Here we have like four or even maybe five, yes, five periods. So frequencies are different. So here we will have omega 1. Here we will have omega 2. And besides that, we also need to take into account this time shifting. Now it's time to return back and see what happens with spectrum if we are performing a shifting of the signal. So consider, for example, this case that we have shifted into the right direction, yes, which was a green part of the signal, BASK2. And in this case, our spectrum is multiplied with this complex exponential matching the time shift value. So we have shifted by value minus tau divided by 2. So we have to multiply with minus jk omega tau divided by 2. Now, for shifting opposite direction, that would be shift of plus tau divided by 2, and therefore we would get here plus sign. Now, the factor itself, this one, has amplitude of 1 always. So it doesn't really affect amplitude if we are considering a single amplitude shift gain. Now, if we will sum up few of these signals together, that can change the spectrum phase, and as a result, this can change also amplitudes. But we need, once again, more than one such component, multiple such components, so that they can interfere each with other, and that would lead to changes in the spectrum. And basically, that's what happens for binary frequency and binary phase shift gain. So, in more general formulation, this theorem is formulated as follows, that for a given signal with a known spectral function, we can perform time shifting in one direction, like this is right direction, by multiplying with negative complex exponential, and in left direction, I think, yes, it would be with a positive complex exponential. So basically, that shift is added up as a phase, which actually closely matches in a harmonic form this expression, omega t plus delta t. Yes? Well, no, not really. Not really. I have missed some brackets here. It would be like this. Or minus, respectively. So, if we have taken that into consideration, now we can write down the expression for the amplitude or magnitude spectrum of periodical zeros in one sequence, represented by spectral coefficients of Fourier series. Yes. So here we have the first amplitude shift gain multiplied with positive time shift, and here we have the second shift gain, amplitude shift gain multiplied with a negative time shifting. Other than that, these have two different frequencies, and we need to make some additional talk about that. So, as you remember, for a frequency modulation, we had a parameter of modulation index. This holds true for binary shift gain as well. So this modulation index is the frequency difference, deviance, divided by the base harmonic. Base harmonic has been calculated before according to this formula. And the first frequency is the carrier central frequency minus half of this deviance. The second frequency is accordingly the sum plus deviance divided by 2. So we can calculate these two frequencies if we are given this index, for example, 2. Yes, and we also know this omega capital. So we just express this deviance. Yes. As a multiplication. And once we have calculated it, we can find out what are our two frequencies, which we have to use here instead of omega 0. For the first modulation, it would be omega 1. For the second modulation, it would be omega 2. Once we have done that all, we can calculate the spectrum. Now, the same approach is used for energetical spectrum, for power spectral density, which shows us how energy of a random signal is distributed in the spectrum. We calculate the power spectral density for the first modulation, for the second modulation, and then we add them up together. This would result in pictures like this. Here we can clearly see our frequency omega 1 and omega 2. As well as here. So basically, you will, without any problems, get these pictures as well. I will once again show you an example in next lecture. And the final modulation type to consider is phase shift keying, which is also a possibility to get as a task in this course project. So let's see what's different there. This turns out to be also a combination of two binary shift keying signals. However, in this case, we are not adding them, but rather subtracting them from each other. So, for example, you can see here that we have harmonic signal minus zero, which gives us the same harmonic signal. Now here we have zero minus harmonic signal, which changes the phase of this harmonic signal to opposite. So it's basically here we have sin, and here we have minus sin, which corresponds to phase shift of P. So basically minus sin X is the same thing as sin X plus P. That's where the information is. It is stored in this phase. And here we have phase zero. So basically speaking, we have initial phase either zero, and then it's this signal, or P. And then it's this signal. And after modulating here, you can see the phase change of the value, and we get binary phase shift keying signal. So once again, we have to perform time shifting here. Yes, you can see that we have shifted in this direction, the first signal, and the second signal in this direction. Sorry. But this time, however, we are using the same frequency for both of those signals. You can see that they have the same number of periods. So we have omega zero for this signal and omega zero for this signal as well. Unlike it was done in binary frequency shift keying. Yes, so this is binary phase shift keying. So literally very little changes. The few changes are that we have changed this sign to minus, and we use the same frequency for both of those amplitude shift keyings. So basically this is even simpler case, since we don't have to actually calculate two different frequencies, and well, it's much simpler. And of course we can make it more difficult if we express this by Euler's formula, but the good news that we don't have to, that MATLAB will be perfectly fine understanding if you want to calculate complex exponential like this exp 1i multiplied by k and so on and so on. So MATLAB will easily handle this operation. So we don't have to make it even more detailed by calculating harmonic signals and so on. We will just use this as it is, and it will work. So for power spectral density, we are going to use the same frequencies too, which literally gives us equal power spectral densities, since we have a square here. Yes, here we had in a formula a square operation. So basically that sign difference has been eliminated, and we have them very similar values, and we can actually just write instead that it's double of binary amplitude shift keying. So let's see. So magnitude spectrum differs from amplitude modulation in the fact that we have no carrier. If we compare binary phase shift keying and binary amplitude shift keying, then binary amplitude shift keying had the highest component as this carrier, which is not energy efficient way to transmit signals. Much more efficient way is to use this approach, phase shift keying, and as we will later see, it's also much more noise immune approach. But that is a talk for another case. So basically, let me just scroll back to amplitude shift keying to show you that actually it was like this. So because we had this component as maximum, we had actually to redistribute the energy for all the other components. So meaning that if we eliminate this, then this free energy is added up to other components and we have greater values than 0.2 for phase shift keying, which can be observed here. We have 0.3. As for power spectral density, we will have here value of 5, whereas for amplitude shift keying we only had 2.5, yes, which is roughly twice as more. So this is the mathematics behind the calculations of the spectrum, and the next lecture I'm going to show you how to use those formulas to calculate the spectrum for each of the modulation types. You will need in your course project to use that only for one modulation type, but I will show you that it's quite simple to calculate each of them. So we will continue again at 3 o'clock and I will show you how to calculate that. Thank you for now for your attention and see you next lecture.